Hello and welcome back everyone to our series on enzyme engineering. We'll be starting today with the enzyme reactors, and we will be dealing with all the ideal cases. And to start with, we will start with the batch operation mode of enzyme reactors. Basically, enzyme reactors can be of many designs, and primarily they have been used, most used design is that of packed bed reactors, but we will be considering the free enzyme reactors as well as the immobilized enzyme reactors. And we can assume batch operation. For batch operation, we can assume that the reaction, in ideal case, the reaction is very well mixed and the condition throughout the reactor is homogeneous. Because the reactor is very well mixed, agitation rate is very high. So the environment across the reactor is homogeneous, that is, there is no temperature or concentration gradient across the reactor. And in batch operation mode, any reactor in when operated in batch operation mode, then it will be only possible to operate it in a batch operation mode when we provide the input once at the start of the reaction, and then obtain the output at the end of the reaction only once. So this situation will be called as batch operation mode. The volume of the reactor throughout a batch operation remains constant, because there is no if there is no leakage. In ideal case, if there is no any sort of detrimental effect to the content of the reactors, so in ideal cases the volume will remain constant. So we will start with free enzymes and also consider immobilized enzyme reaction in a mixed batch reactor. And packed bed is another case which we will be dealing when we will be discussing about the plug flow operation. So currently let's start with the batch operation. So let us consider an ideal batch reactor which has a reactor volume of V. Okay, now before beginning with the designing of this reactor, we must know that for designing a reactor, we must understand what is the most important factor for operating the reactor. And the most important factor in reactor operations is the cost, because a reactor is operated primarily because we want to obtain some product, or we want to convert certain substance. So that is the substrate. You want to convert that substrate into something other, some other thing. Either you want to degrade the substrate, or objective might be to degrade a substance that is not very useful or that is very harmful, or we might be interested in the product of the enzymatic reaction, or even both. So so the most important factor in designing a reactor is always the cost. And the cost of a batch reactor primarily depends upon the time we are going to operate it. So the lesser time we take for operating a batch reactor, the more cost yielding will be that reactor. That is, it will be more profitable to finish a work in a shorter time than to continue it for a longer duration. So we will be designing our equations and we will be targeting to obtain the batch time in a batch reactor while operating a batch reactor. So we will begin with a well mixed ideal batch reactor, which is very well mixed. The volume of the reactor is V, that is, the reacting volume is V, and it will be constant throughout the reaction or throughout the reactor operation. Now we will assume that substrate concentration throughout the reactor is S, this is small s, and the product concentration is P. Now the concentration will change with respect to time, but it will be homogeneous across the reactor. Okay, so now applying mass balances. Since substrate will be converted to product by Michaelis-Menten kinetics, because this is an enzyme reactor, so Michaelis-Menten kinetics is assumed that the enzyme follows ideal Michaelis-Menten kinetics. Therefore, by mass balance, rate of substrate consumption will be given by substrate concentration into volume. Now this is the
mass of substrate, because substrate concentration term multiplied by volume of the reaction will provide us with the total mass of substrate within this reactor. So rate of change of the mass of substrate in the vessel will be equal to the rate of consumption by Michaelis-Menten kinetics. And again, since this is in terms of concentration, so we will multiply this reaction, this rate of reaction with volume to obtain mass, that rate of mass consumption. So now we will integrate this equation. To obtain the batch time, on in now this since V is a constant, so we can write this equation again as now, since volume is a constant, so it moves out of the derivative and it gets cancelled out. Now we have this equation. Now this equation can be integrated, and we will rearrange the equation so that the substrate terms comes along with the substrate derivative, and the time function comes at the other end, because ultimately we have to obtain our equation for time. So this, after rearrangement, this equation can be written as this term will go this side. So it will be minus Km plus S, this will go above, and this term will go as the denominator. So this would become Km plus S upon V max S ds. Okay, so we will obtain this equation, and now integrating it through limits of initial conditions to the to any condition within in between, that is to time t, and from starting from substrate concentration, that was if we assume integrating this, we can be assumed to be equation 2. Integrating equation 2 with limits t equal to 0 to batch time, let's see, we denote it with tb, and initial substrate concentration s naught to final substrate concentration, or simply we can write it down as sf, or we can even write it as S. So we'll take the SF part so that it's denoted as final substrate concentration. So now when we apply the limits 0 to TB, and this would be equal to minus now Km plus Km and Vmax are assumed to be constant throughout the reaction, so this would help us in further solving this integral S0 to SF the limits. Now if we multiply this whole term, this whole equation by minus 1, so we will get the by rule we can, if you multiply this equation by minus 1, or if we remove this minus sign, we can change the limits we can simply, if we change the limits, this minus sign will be removed. There will be no need to multiply the whole term. So simply by changing the limits, we can
finish off with the minus sign. Minus sign, and I will integrate this part
so that we can solve as early as possible. So if we integrate this, this term will become t, and upper limit is tb and lower limit is 0. So this will be its solution. And on changing the limits, this minus sign will vanish, and we will have sf2 s0, the reciprocated limits. And this term can be now broken, since this is a complex function, so this has to be broken down into two terms so that we can have we can integrate it easily. So this, on breaking this term, we will have km upon v max 1 upon s ds as one term, and the other term will become 1 upon v max ds. Okay, we'll break the denominator with between these two terms, and so we will get these results: km upon v max s, km upon, sorry, this is in multiplication, sorry, I'm really sorry, this should be in multiplication. This is a multiplied term, this term is multiplied here, so we'll get these results. Okay, and in this term the ss will get cancelled in this side, and the remaining term 1 upon v max will remain, and this is a constant, so this will move out of the integral term, and km upon v max is a constant, so it will move out of this term. So integration of 1 upon s with respect to ds would become natural log s, and applying the limits we will get tb minus 0 is tb, and here km upon v max were constants, so this is out of integral term, and here we will have natural log of s, and upper limit is s naught, so s naught minus log s naught minus log sf, we can write it as log s naught upon sf, and this side 1 upon v max is a constant, and integration of ds would become s. Applying the limits, we will have upper limit minus lower limit. So this is the batch equation for free enzymes. For free enzymes, if you want to obtain a particular substrate conversion, we can apply the initial and the final concentration values here of the substrate, and we can obtain what time will it take for this conversion to take place. So this is our design equation for batch operation. Now if in our batch operation, if we are encountering deactivation of enzymes, so the condition would change a little bit, and from equation 1 we know that in equation 1 we know that this Vmax would no more be a constant if we are encountering enzyme deactivation. So let us just revise what deactivation does to total enzyme concentration, total active enzyme concentration, as and also how it affects Vmax. So we can write it as a case, or we can just, you know, start with for enzyme deactivation, because enzyme deactivation is a problem in many reactors, as I have discussed in my previous lectures, that enzymes are very fragile molecules and they are very large and very fragile. So deactivation of enzyme occurs at many instants if not carefully handled, because there are not many robust enzymes. So for deactivation, we know that the active enzyme concentration varies as an exponential function, and we assume that the deactivation of enzyme is a first order kinetics. So we got an exponential equation for the deactivation kinetics. So this was our rate of this was the effect on active enzyme concentration of deactivation. So it was exponentially dependent, and KD we have the deactivation rate constant, and time is the time taken for deactivation, or time after which we are evaluating our active enzyme concentration. And we also know that the Vmax of any enzymatic reaction is always given by the rate constant of the limiting step. By evaluating the rate of the limiting step, so rate of limiting step at maximum case would be dependent upon the total enzyme in that solution. And due to deactivation, we also found that Vmax gets altered, and Vmax also depends exponentially on the deactivation on the deactivation of the enzyme. So now in equation 1 we will be using this value of Vmax. So substituting value of Vmax, in equation 1 we'll get, now V is a constant and I'll cancel out V and I'll take this equation as ds by dt, and instead of Vmax this would become Vmax naught e to the power minus kdt s. Or yes, well, let's write it down here only, upon Km plus S. So this was our final equation for final design equation for free enzymes without deactivation. Now this we are studying case for free enzymes with deactivation. Now if we integrate this, we'll get what? Now rearranging it, so this is a term where time of time is there, so this would go with the time derivative, so we can write it down as e to the power minus kdt into dt. Okay, and this term will move here, and we can also write the minus sign here itself. We will keep the minus sign this side. This would become Km plus S. Upon Vmax naught. Now Vmax naught is a constant because it is the value of Vmax before deactivation. So this will be a constant. Now applying limits from 0 to batch time TB, and from
S naught to SF. The limits would be same. We'll apply the same limits in this case also. So now if we solve this, now if we solve this down, now this is again a complex function, so integration of this term would be e to the power minus kd t b the upper limit minus e to the power minus kd. Now the lower limit is 0, so we will put 0 here upon the differential of this term with respect to dt. So the differential would become minus kd will be constant and differential of t with respect to t would be 1. If I write it clearly, it will be much more clear to you. This needs to be done as dt of dt. Okay, actually this will be, let me write the complete step so that you won't get confused. On integrating this complex term, we must divide the result of integration with the differential of the differential of the function in the power of the exponent, because this is again a function. This power of this exponent is a function, so this must be divided. The differential of this term must be divided to complete the integration. So this will be the situation. And this side, we will break this apart and we'll flip the limits to nullify this negative sign. So we will have, now the limits would change from SF to S naught. Okay, and now on breaking this, we will get Km upon V max naught 1 upon S ds plus, it would become SF to SF naught. This would be 1 upon V max naught ds. So evaluating this step, we get e to the power minus kdt tb minus e to this would become e to the power 0, and anything to the power 0 is 1. So this would become minus 1 whole upon minus kd would remain in the denominator. Now evaluating this side, we would have Km upon V max naught is a constant, and integration of this term would become natural log, applying the limits S naught log S naught minus log SF. This could also be written as S naught upon natural log S naught upon SF. I'm skipping a few steps to just shorten the time of the lecture. So okay, this was a simple function, hence there is no complexity in it. This is a little bit complex integration. So this would be our integral of this term. Now moving on to this term, the 1 upon V max naught is a constant, it would move out of the integral, and here we'll have S naught minus SF, upper limit minus lower limit. Now we have this equation, and now rearranging the values because we need to obtain the batch time. So to obtain the batch time, we will let the exponential function to be here, and rest all the functions we will take on the other side of the equation. So first of all, we can take minus kd into this side, and the equation would become e to the power minus kd tb minus 1 equal to minus kd will go upside, and it will become minus kd into Km upon Vmax, Km upon Vmax naught, natural log S naught upon SF plus S naught minus SF upon Vmax naught. Now this minus 1 when taken here will become plus 1 on this side of the equation. It would become plus 1, and now we will have e to the power minus kd tb equals to, this will become plus 1, and we already have minus kd here, minus kd Km upon Vmax naught natural log S naught upon SF plus S naught minus SF upon Vmax naught. Now we can obtain value of TB by applying anti-natural logarithm both sides. By applying logarithm on both sides, natural logarithm on both sides. And now when applying logarithm, we will have, this would become minus KD TB, because natural logarithm of E would be 1. I'll write it down in this step. Natural log of E, this is the value of this natural log of E is 1, and this side, this would be minus, we have applied natural logarithm, so this would be natural log of 1 minus kd km upon Vmax naught natural log S naught upon SF plus S naught minus SF upon Vmax naught . Now this is 1. To obtain value of TB, KD must be taken this side, and it would come in the denominator. So our final equation for the case of deactivation, batch time when deactivation is occurring with free enzymes, batch time of the free enzyme reactor where deactivation is in process, so this would become minus 1 upon kd tb equals to minus, this would go this side in the denominator, and the rest of the term would be same, 1 minus kd Km upon Vmax naught natural log S naught upon SF plus S naught minus SF upon V max naught this will be our final equation. For the deactivation case, this is our final equation. Now, if we are operating an immobilized enzyme in a batch well mixed mode. In a batch reactor, a continuously mixed batch reactor, then that would be a much, much more complex situation, because then our equation one would be modified as, now I'll consider the next equation after this equation, that is for immobilized reactors, for immobilized enzyme reactors, the equation ds by dt would get converted into neta, that is the effectiveness factor, Vmax s upon Km plus s. Now these are two non-linear terms. Neta is also dependent upon substrate concentration, and it depends how we are operating the immobilized enzyme reactor. Even if it is well mixed, then we will have certain EDR, external diffusion restrictions and internal diffusion restrictions. So this effectiveness factor is the total net effectiveness factor that we will observe. So we can use this equation, and then we can integrate it by using the latest computational tools, various softwares we have for computing complex mathematical functions. So we'll use them to obtain the batch time for immobilized enzyme reactors. So we'll not be dealing with them as for now. So this is all we have for a batch reactor, and this is for the ideal cases. Depending upon our individual situations, we can modify our assumptions, and we can come up to different conclusions and derive different equations. Hope you enjoyed the lecture. Thank you. Have a nice day.